Kamu baru lulus S1, bingung mau kuliah Magister Ilmu Biomedis di mana? Ayo mendaftar di program studi Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSUD. Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSUD telah membuka penerimaan mahasiswa baru tahun ajaran 2022-2023. Program studi Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSUD membuka 4 bidang peminatan yaitu farmakologi, biokimia, fisiologi, dan histologi. Laboratorium Fakultas Kedokteran UNSUD telah dilengkapi fasilitas yang dapat melakukan pemeriksaan genetika dan biomolekular, pembuatan jaringan, animal house, dan pemeriksaan lainnya untuk mendukung pengembangan ilmu dalam dunia pendidikan kedokteran. Mari bergabung di program studi Magister Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSUD. Bersama UNSUD, unggul, cerdas, terpercaya.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Alhamdulillah, praise and thanks to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the grace and the gifts we are still given health, the blessing of age and the extraordinary opportunities so we can... gather in today's seminar. And I would like to say, may peace upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has guided us into the right ways of life. Before we start our seminar today, let us pray to Allah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Raditu billahi rabbal wa bil islami dinan wa bil Muhammadin nabiyya wa rasula. Before we start our seminar, I would like to tell that the seminar will be divided into multiple segments. First, the opening, and then we have the presentations by speaker 1. And then the presentation by speaker 2. Then questions and answer sessions and the closing ceremony. Dear Honorable Dean of Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara, Faculty of Medicine, Dr. Siti Masliana Siregar, ENT, Specialist Consultant, and Vice Dean of Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara, Faculty of Medicine, Dr. Muhammad Edi Saputra, ENT, Specialist. Dear Honorable Speakers, Professor Dr. Haji Abdurrahman, MKS, and Dr. Hendra Sutisna, Master of Biomedicine and Family Medicine Specialist. Dear Honorable Moderator, Dr. Fardela Lufiana, Master of Biomedicine, and all of the ladies and gentlemen, very warm greetings to each and every one of you. Welcome to the Medical Science Seminar Series with the theme Complementary Medicine in Anatomy Review. I am Muhammad Salsabil Yesudan Nasution, the co-moderator of today's event, will guide you until the seminar's end. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first agenda, there will be a welcoming speech from the Vice Dean of Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara, Faculty of Medicine. Please welcome Dr. Muhammad Edi Saputra, ENT Specialist. The time is yours.
Thank you, moderator. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let us praise and thank the presence of Allah Almighty and our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so we can still gather this room, Zoom, without any difficulties at all and in good health. My name is Muhammad Ibish Nasutin, ENT Specialist, Vice Dean, Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara. It is such an honor for me to speak and welcome you to Medical Science Seminar Series. With them, Complementary Medicine in Anatomy. Thank you for penelitian, pengembangan, dan pengabdian kepada masyarakat and Department of Anatomy that have prepared this seminar. My honorable speaker, Dr. Hendra Sutisna, MBOMED, SPKKLP, UKKLK, Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara. And our special speaker, Professor Dr. Dr. Haji Abdurrahman, SPAK, Professor of Anatomy, Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Erlangga, Surabaya. Nice to meet you, sir. My honorable lecturers of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara and all the participants, especially our fellow students. Faculty of Medicine Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara proudly presents Well Science series. In today's seminar, we will discuss about complementary medicine and anatomy review. Thank you to each and every one of you for being here today in this wonderful room. So, well, I wouldn't like to take too much of your time. Once again, thank you for our special speaker, Prof. Abdurrahman. One day we will begin and make more collaborations, not only in the seminar, but also in other activities or others events. So that is all for me. Once again, thank you for all participants attending this seminar. Walhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Eddie, for the welcoming speech. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let's start the seminar, which is going to be led by Dr. Fardel Alfiana, Master of Biomedicine. The stage is yours.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Sabil. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. In this seminar, the time of this seminar is about complementary medicine. There are two sessions of this seminar. First session is about acupuncture point from anatomy review, and the second session will about cupping therapy in anatomy review also. But at the end of the session, there will be discussion. So I hope that all audience would have made some question and then will text in the chat box. Okay, for the effectiveness of time, allow me to introduce our first speaker. His name is Professor Dr. Dr. Haji Abdurrahman M.Kes, PA Consultant. Nice to see you, Prof. Hello, Prof. Assalamualaikum, Prof. Has joined. Assalamualaikum, Prof. Nice to meet you, Prof. Have you heard my question?
Can you hear me?
Hello. Okay, assalamualaikum, Prof. Can you hear my voice?
Salam.
Okay, nice to meet you, Prof.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good morning. Is it clear for you?
I'm sorry, your voice is not clear here. Have you heard my voice, Prof? Clearly?
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello.
Assalamualaikum, Prof. Can you hear my voice?
Hello?
Yes, Prof.
Hello?
Yes, I can hear your voice. Can you hear my voice also?
Yes, so clear. Thank you.
Okay, let me continue, Prof.
Yes.
Okay. Nice to see you, Prof. This is my first time to see you. Allow me to read your curriculum vitae, Prof. Professor Dr. Dr. Abdurrahman, M.Kes, PA Consultant, is a professor and chair in Anatomy, Histology, okay. Pharmacology Department, Medical Faculty, Erlangga University, Surabaya. He was becoming General Chairperson of Indonesian Association of Anatomists 2008 until 2011. He was a president of the Asia Pacific International Congress of Anatomists in 2011 and also executive board member of the Asia Pacific International Congress of Anatomists from 2011 until now. He is representative member of the International Federation of Anatomists Association since 2014 and also member of East Java ED Expert Council until now. He was graduated from Medical Faculty Erlangga University in 1991 and also then continue his study in master degree 2001 at the same university. And then he was also postgraduate from doctoral degree in 2005 at the same university also. And finally, he became professor of Erlangga University in 2019. Okay, Professor Abdurrahman will talk about complementary medicine, acupuncture therapy in anatomy review. To make better use of time, Prof, please present your presentation for 40 minutes. This time is yours, Prof. Okay, Prof. Dr. Dr. Abdurrahman, can we start our presentation? Miss Adinda, please help me to calling Prof. Dr. Abdurrahman, please.
Okay.
I'm sorry for the audience because of the terrible in connection. I hope you can wait for a minute.
Terus ini bukan
I'm sorry for the audience because of the signal trouble. We go ahead to our second speaker first. I will read, allow me to read the CV of our second speaker. His name is Dr. Hendra Sutisna, Biomedical Magister, SPKKLP, IFO Consultant. He was graduated from Universitas Islam Sumatera Utara in 2006, and he was continue his study to Master of Biomedical Sciences in Universitas Sumatera Utara in 2013. And in 2020, he got Family Medicine Specialist and Primary Services from Indonesian Collegium of Family Medicine. Dr. Hendra is active in training and also a speaker at several seminars such as cupping, acupressure, acupuncture, ruqyah, bone and joint reposition. He has also been an oral presenter at Malaysian Anatomical Association Conference in 2019. His employment history, he was GP at Muhammadiyah Hospital in North Sumatra. He was also GP in General Pratama Clinic Call Aisha Medan, and now he is also a GP in UMSU Pratama Clinic. Dr. Hendra also as lecturer at UMSU in Anatomy Department, and he is also cupping trainer and chief editor in several journal. He is also active in many organizations such as Ikatan Dokter Indonesia, Indonesian Cupping Association North Sumatra, and also executive board of the International Islamic Medicine Forum in 2020 until now. Okay, Dr. Hendra, to make better use of time, please present your presentation. I remind again for audience, if you have any question, please chat in the chat box. The presentation for 40 minutes, Dr. Hendra, the time is yours.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Fardela. Good morning, everybody, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Hendra Sutisna. I'm a chief of Department of Anatomy in FK UMSU. And now I will presentation my paper in Complementary Medicine in Anatomy Review, actually in cupping point in Anatomy Review. Okay? Yeah. In the beginning, I will explain about the. In the beginning, I will explain about the history of cupping, yeah, ladies and gentlemen. The history of beginning of cupping still was various opinions. However, one thing that is certain is that the spirit of cupping therapy occurred to various countries, including Indonesia. Jadi Bapak Ibu semua bawa sejarah ini masih tumpang tindih, masih banyak pendapat sana sini yang jelas hijamah atau cupping therapy has been known for a long time since ancient Egypt according to other reference. Yeah. Although cupping has been practiced for thousands of years, it was only brought to Indonesia by Muslim traders from the Arab world. Yaman, Egypt, etc. during the 13th century kingdom. Dan ini disebarkan oleh banyak para santri-santri kita yang belajar di pesantren dan hingga sekarang berkembang hingga tahun 2000-an mulai dikenal banyak orang sebagai cupping and hijamah. Nah, cupping therapy is generally categories into dry cupping and wet cupping. Jadi ada yang cupping bekam kering dan bekam basah. Dry cupping is widely practiced in TCM, traditional Chinese medicine models. And wet cupping is widely practiced in TCM 2 and Tibu Nabawi models. In today modern area, although cupping is traditional treatment, many experts have studied cupping and proven it benefits scientifically. Jadi memang di masa-masa sekarang banyak pakar peneliti yang mulai tertarik meneliti tentang cupping therapy. Nowadays, many people use complementary alternative medicine methods. And the importance of cupping hijamah is from hadis Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Ibnu Mas'ud said, this is hadis Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, an usriya bihi annahu lam yamur ala mala'i minal malaikati illa amaruhu anmur ummataka bil hijamah. Jadi memang Rasulullah saat Isra wal Mi'raj setiap berjumpa dengan sekelompok malaikat selalu dipesankan oleh para malaikat di perjalanannya untuk perintahkanlah umatmu berhijamah. In other hadis Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, inna amsala ma tadawitum bihil hijamah wal kustul bahri. The most ideal methods of treatment that you use are hijamah, cupping, and kustul bahri. Hadis riwayat Bukhari Muslim. Cupping methods. How the cupping methods? Cupping methods is complementary traditional medicine, generally divided into dry cupping and wet cupping. Wet cupping is divided into two methods, namely the TCM methods and that's called cupping puncturing. And Tibu Nabawi, the method cupping puncturing and cupping again. Cupping one is the application of suction negative pressure by creating of vacuum. So vacuum itu akan membuat tekanan negatif ya pada saat cupping pertama. The cupping mechanism will create a vacuum that attract interstitial fluid and CPS dissolve in the skin tissue of the cupping target area. Jadi memang saat cupping pertama terjadi pergeseran cairan-cairan interstitial ya dan juga CPS. CPS itu adalah causative pathological substance atau substance penyebab-penyebab penyakit like cholesterol, like uric acid, like free radicals and ejecta. And so that it can cause skin redness, phtheke and ecchymosis depending on the physical elasticity of the skin. And the puncturing and cupping too, yeah, cause scarification of the skin, which then cause capillaries to rupture and then the local skin secretes peripheral blood and interstitial fluid containing a lot of CPS, causative pathological substance, assisted by a negative pressure from cupping, which can counter the osmotic pressure of interstitial and capillaries. And the pathophysiology of cupping, how cupping work. The mechanism of cupping occur due to the body's response to acute hypoxic stimuli because the mechanical stimulation of cupping will cause the strain on collagen fiber and autonomic nerve that stimulate the production on neuropeptides and neurohormone, such as the release of natural skin analgesic in the form of endorphin hormones, melatonin, acute inflammatory mediators, and neurotransmitter, so that at the time of incision scarification, no pain occurs. And if an organ has impaired function, then our body, ya, saat tubuh kita melakukan rasa sakit, akan feel the pain, ya. The body has a response to convey pain from the nerve to be forward to brain which is tell us that the organ is sick. Jadi saat tubuh sakit, ada organ tertentu yang mengalami kekurangan perfusi dan sebagainya akan memberikan stimulus ke otak. The disease organs show that the microcirculation in the blood that feed the organ is disrupted due to various kind of causal substance known as causative pathological substance, CPS, such as bacteria, virus, high cholesterol, high sugar level, uric acid, chemical, or free radical, and the others, which cannot be eliminated by the body. Actually, we have renal and we have liver, but sometimes we produce many CPS in our life. So we must tambahkan ya dengan bekam sebagai salah satu terapi yang membantu fungsi-fungsi organ tersebut. Negative pressure in cupping therapy is believed to be able to attract toxins, free radicals and metabolic waste, yeah, as excess causative pathological substance from the deep of soft tissue to rise to the surface of the skin or collect the substance from peripheral blood vessel and gather in blood vessel at the cupping point. The incision of scarification of the skin surface at the cupping point is one way to remove filtration this collection of substance atau CPS, so that in the end the body avoid the damage effect of the CPS. Okay, capillary dilatation can also occur at site distant from the freezing site, leading to the improved vascular microcirculation. Furthermore, the release of corticotropin releasing factor and other releasing factor by adenohypophysis, CRF, will then cause the formation of ACTH, acetylcholine hormone, corticotropin, and corticosteroid. This corticosteroid has the effect of healing inflammation and stabilizing cell permeability. While the histamine group that it causes profit benefit in the process of reparation of damaged cell and tissue and spur the formation the reticular endothelial cells, which will increase the resistance and immunity of the body. Yeah. So, how about cupping in muscle relaxation? The act of muscle relaxation in cupping can increase the body immunity. Muscle relaxation will cause blood circulation to be smoother in the relaxation area. The smooth blood circulation causes the smooth flow of immune cells, such as leukocyte, to the muscle relaxation site, local rapid immunity effect. In addition, the act of muscle relaxation will increase hormone oxytocin and increase the immune system response too. Okay, cupping causes an increase in the number of macrophage cell too. Also, an increase in macrophage cell is marker of cellular immune response. In addition, cupping action also increase microcirculation and the end capillary endothelial cell repair, accelerate granulation and angiogenesis in the tissue regional. Okay, how is the concept of cupping point determination? The concept of cupping point location is the first is sunnah point. This is ini adalah dasar yang utama dari Rasulullah SAW. And the second, a point corresponding to the location of the complaint. Ya, jadi di titik-titik bekam itu bisa kita tentukan dari titik lokasi, titik keluhan. And the third, a point in the vicinity of the complaint occasion, the fourth, the point that is paired with complaint occasion, jadi area yang berlawanan, ya, berpasangan, then the five point based on the problematic organ. Jadi kalau ada organ yang bermasalah sesuai dengan diagnosa sebelumnya, maka titik letak organ tertentu sesuai dengan dermatologinya, maka itu akan kita jadikan titik sasaran. Okay, basic concept of cupping point determination, there are the current cupping. Yeah, the current cupping point are determined based on the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the physiological anatomy of the body. And then maybe acupuncture point and the experience of scholar therapist empirically. There may be various version of cupping point, but the common one is based on a medical approach, namely based on the physiological anatomy of the human body. So the body's physiological anatomy cupping point are based on the location of organs, organ function, and nervous system. The focus of attention for the nervous system is on the nerve fiber that branches off from the spinal cord, dermatome, myotome, and viscerotome. And the principle of cupping point, based on various evidence reference, the determination of cupping point varies widely. Some reference customize cupping point based on the complaint. Ya, jadi berbasis masalah keluhannya. And the illness, while other use one standard point for any complaint. In principle, it can be conclude that all parts of the body surface, as long as they are applicable, can be used as cupping point from reference in Roman times, the doctor of that era perform cupping using cucurbits on the head region to treat all kind of this other origin from the head region. They also use cupping for acute poisoning by cupping at the local point of poisoning so that the negative pressure of cupping could draw the poison back out of the body and prevent the poison from spreading. Next. And in general, the most common use cupping point are the area at the large number of muscle because there are also many blood vessels in this area. Jadi memang penetapan secara umum titik bekam adalah karena banyaknya vaskularisasi di area-area titik target bekam itu. In this area. This point include point in the back, di punggung, chest, ya, abdomen, and buttock area. There are also cupping point other than muscle area, which are also an option because of the richness of the area with blood vessels such as the neck, intrascapular, in the protuberancia area, behind the ears, in the middle and top of the head, chin joint, yeah, area, yeah, and others. Sunnah cupping point, ya, yeah, ini berdasarkan titik sunnah cupping point. Location are cupping point area based on the hadis Rasulullah SAW, but in amalia, kaulia, takriria, and shifa. In other words, the cupping point are applied to Rasulullah SAW as client who is cupped, because the Prophet never acts as a cupper. Rasulullah SAW conveyed it verbally or someone else it and was recognized by Rasulullah, or Rasulullah conveyed a description of the point of cupping. So the fact is the position of this sunnah cupping point was not explained by the Prophet. But in describing them, we can get from the information by companion or can be understood by reading various books of suruh hadis or understanding them through dictionary or as explained by scholar and also medical science study from doctor or who developed Tibu Nabawi. Therefore, it is necessary to study the point of cupping sunnah juxtaposed with medical science such of anatomy and physiology of the human body. Ladies and gentlemen, general concept of sunnah cupping is based on some example of above tradition from the many traditions. It can be seen that the location of sunnah cupping point example by Prophet Muhammad including two points, including their general point used as point for maintaining health include the head, stomach, bed, center, and the neck. The special point is localized following the area of pain such as head point, headache, joint, and joint. Sunnah cupping point in anatomical perspective in one the reports, Gotz et al. Focus on one the cupping point recommended by prophetic cupping, refer to as al-kahil, which is the upper back area, intrascapular area. This point is also one of the most important point on the acupuncture meridian because anatomically it contain a lot of brown fat and is bright above important anatomical structure such as the sympathetic ganglia, the thoracic duct, ductus thoracicus, and the blood vessel that carry blood to heart and the brain. Considering the position of this point as the meeting place of the blood vessel and nerve, Gotz et al. Concluded that the cupping through the traction force of negative pressure at this point will be able to attract more blood and tissue so as to remove more waste material. Thus, cupping at this point will directly improve that the body's cellular metabolism, enhance cellular immunity, and regulate blood biochemical balance. And then, like Umumogits, Titi Umumogits, this position is Umumogits position. This is sunnah cupping point located in the upper center of the head, namely at the meeting of the two upper head bones, parietal, os parietal, in the form of the middle line of connection, sutura sagittalis, of the two parietal bones and adds with imaginary line connecting the two ear and is between the brachma point, the fontanel anterior and the lambda point, fontanel posterior, anatomically the highest point of the head is called the vertex. Anatomically study of the cupping point, the Umumogits point is at the top of the head, vertex point, which is the between the brachma point anterior fontanella and the lambda point posterior fontanella. The functional area of the brain around the point Umumogits is in projection. The cerebral cortex area, precentral gyrus and postcentral gyrus, which is the cerebral cortex of the association of human motoric and sensory centers. And alia fuk di depan sedikit dari titik Umumogits, the position of alia fuk is sunnah cupping point is the middle front of the head, namely it is meeting of frontal bone of the head frontal with the two hemisphere of the upper bone of the head, parietal os parietal. There are also those we call the point between the forehead with the point of Mugits, Umumogits alhama. Anatomically, its meeting duct is called the name of brachma point. Jadi titik yafuk itu sebenarnya di titik brachma. Anatomical study, the cupping point anatomically, yafuk point is located just above the small fontanel, also called brachma point. The area around yafuk point is projection frontal cortex. Area frontal cortex of the brain and the prefrontal cortex area which play a role in cognitive function. Jadi titik aliafuk ini sangat baik untuk meningkatkan kecerdasan kognitif. This is many cupping point. in sunnah that we review in anatomical review, yeah, the position of aras, yeah, anatomy study is coming by anatomy, the aras point is located in all area of the head that are covered with hair other than umumugis and yafuk. In placement of aras, yeah, is aras good for hearing, yeah, central area hearing and close to the center emotional control, which manage feeling, emotion, sadness, fear, happiness, yeah. So the head, which is the projection of the cortex back of the brain, occipital lobe, which is visual area, and the others. There's many benefitly from aras in back hijama point. Al-Akhdain, this is in the neck, yeah. In the neck position, the facial, the cervical throat and fold, and should not be on the side of front of the neck, yeah, because this is danger, yeah. Anatomically study of cupping point, anatomically this Akhdain point located in cervical third and fourth vertebra, yeah. This is nervous third and fourth directly innervate in inner surface of the trapezius muscle ever back. So jadi kalau punya nyeri leher pundak, ini bagus di Al-Akhdain. Next, Al-Kahil. Al-Kahil we call titik utama, ya. Kita bilang titik utama karena Rasulullah pernah bersabda bahwa titik ini adalah bisa menghindari, mencegah 72 jenis penyakit. I don't know what the disease, but this is it is the hadis. Hadis Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The position Al-Kahil is cervical spine, yeah. And anatomically study is cupping point, anatomically is Al-Kahil point is under the protrusion of the seventh cervical spine as opposed to first thoracic spine. At the placement of the cupping point again is thoracic spine, the area again spinal cord of the chest of which stimulate the work of the heart. Heart rate to be more optimal, the area around the Al-Kahil point is the projection of nerve dermatome area and upper chest area. And Azharul A'la. Azharul A'la ini pundak, di pundak atau di punggung. Sepanjang punggung Azharul. Ada yang upper Azharul A'la and lower Azharul Wasauti, ya. Yeah. And Azharul A'la ini, ya, yeah, this in about through three finger, ya, yeah, outside of the protrusion spinal, the of the spine, ya. Yeah. At this point Azharul A'la is located opposite the middle of shoulder blade, scapula precisa, ya. Yeah. Anatomically-nya, ya, based on the underlying study of freezing at the point Azharul A'la, it affect several organ that are connect, including the bronchus, bronchiolus, airway, heart, and lungs. Ya.
Yeah. Excuse me, Dr. Hendra, maybe we have 5 minutes left.
Oh ya, yeah. Azharul Wasauti, ya, yeah. And then kajian anatomis bekamnya, and many others, ya. Yeah. We will share the PowerPoint if you want to menginginkan, ya, yeah, dari presentasi ini. Jadi banyak, ya, yeah, banyak presentasi yang kita baca, namun dalam keterbatasan waktu ini kita bisa padakan Al-Warik point and the others, ya, yeah. And trigger point in traditional, ya, yeah, jadi according traditional medicine under the skin, muscle, and fascia, there is a point or point that have special properties, ya, yeah, between one point and another point are interconnect longitudinally and transversally and form nets or nets, ya. Yeah. This mesh can be equated with meridian, with the mesh there is close relationship between the upper and lower parts and the body, ya, yeah, between the inside and outside, between the left side of the body, of the right side, between organ and tissue, under the skin, between one organ and other organ. Between organ in hands and feet, yeah, in fit between solid organ, hollow organ, and so on, so that they form in inseparable with unit and can reach simulation. Trigger point in modern machine juga memberi manfaat ya untuk dasarnya bagaimana penentuan cupping point in anatomically. Okay, this is skin and anatomy target in hijama cupping, yeah. And this is the reason how to hijama work in the body. Yeah, anatomy of the skin dermatome. This is the segmental anatomy. Segmental anatomy is the basis of this mutual interaction of the spinal vegetative nervous system, a map for diagnosis and treatment with muscular tension and pain, posture anatomy anomalies, skin alteration, facial expression and gesturing leading the way for the segmental therapy via acupuncture, neurotherapy, manual therapy like cupping therapy. Yeah. This is the segment vertebra, yeah, dermatome, myotome, sclerotome, enterotome, and this basis the interaction between the surface and inside of the body, the spinal nervous system plus autonomic nervous system. The segmental and metamerism allow for interaction between the body, surface, and the internal organs, which can be utilized for the diagnosis. Okay, the structure of an organization consisting of subdivision segmental is typically of blueprint vertebral body segmentally already, ya, ada dermatom, myotom, sclerotom, enterotom, bahkan neurotom and ke internal organ. This is from embryological development. So we know the somite, ya, dermatom, myotom, sclerotom from the embryological, yeah. So head zone reflect part from the skin, yeah. This is a reset, yeah. Head zone, every skin segment at the same time also has neural connection to certain viscera in the thoracic abdominal and sacral space and cutiviscereal viscerocutaneous, yeah. Jadi this is the reset, yeah,
in 2 minutes left
tahun 2014, yeah. Bagaimana saat kita meletakkan cupping point, ya, bekam pada satu titik cupping point di permukaan kulit, memiliki hubungan kesamaan, ya, dalam jalur dermatom, myotom, dan enterotom. Maka if saat organ sakit, misalnya lambung bermasalah atau pencernaan bermasalah, maka kita bekam di area yang sesuai dengan dermatom, myotomnya. Bisa lanjut, ya, ini dia, ya, bagaimana jalur-jalur lintasan sarafnya, ya. Oke, okay, I think this is the conclusion that penentuan cupping point titik bekam berdasarkan anatomical landmark, ya. Oke, okay, so organ projection location based on anatomical landmark, anatomical site for practicing with cupping, many site in our body, ya, practitioner and patient and another side for practicing with cupping therapy, yeah. This is the journal, yeah. Determination of locate and general anatomical. Jadi bahwa satu titik poin bisa saja local anatomical site, localized specific to site and pathology and offering complaints. Aims the clear interstitial fluid, interstitial space, lymphatic fluid, exudates, and edema site. Benefically for removing local fluid collection in local CPS causa of the disease and complaint. But general anatomical site, it further aims to cleanse the blood of the any type of CPS that is in the bloodstream. The cupping point is rich in blood supply and has a rough flat surface, beneficial for application of more cup for certain condition, however less effective than local point for local tissue clearance.
Okay, Dr. Hendra, just, the time is up.
It. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you Dr. Hendra for the great presentation. Maybe we enter the discussion session first while waiting for Professor Abdulrahman has joined us. Okay, there are some question in chat box. There are some question that I can mention first to Dr. Hendra. How mechanism of action about wet cupping to improve disease? How mechanism of action about wet cupping to improve the disease, and how the cupping in how to cupping in human head? Give me advice and its benefit.
Okay. Actually, I have explained about the cupping method, but never mind. The cupping is the pathophysiology of cupping. The mechanism of cupping occurs due to the body's response to acute hypoxic stimuli, because the mechanical stimulation of cupping will cause the strain. Yeah, we cause a strain and collagen fiber and autonomic nerve that stimulate the production of neuropeptides, yeah, and neurohormone, as I said, release the natural skin analgesic in the form endorphin hormones, opioid hormones in endogen, melatonin, acute inflammatory mediator and neurotransmitter, so that the time incision scarification in pain occur. So how about if an organ impair function like head, yeah, cephalgia maybe, yeah, and our body feeling pain, the body has respond to convert pain from the nerve to be forward, yeah. The disease organ show that the microcirculation in the blood that fits the organ is disrupted due to various kind of causal substance known as causative pathological substance. So, saat kepala sakit, cephalgia, like headaches maybe, it patophisiologinya saat terjadi itu adalah aliran darah yang perfusi darah yang kurang ke organ yang bersangkutan, ya, termasuk dalam hal ini ke kepala, termasuk di cerebral, ya. Nah, semua organ pada prinsipnya saat mengalami kekurangan darah, ya, kekurangan suplai darah, oksigen berarti kurang, ya, nutrisi kurang, glukosa kurang, itu akan memberikan sinyal nyeri, ya, sinyal nyeri ke otak. Untuk apa? Untuk kita menyelesaikan masalah itu, agar kita segera mengantisipasi masalah yang kurang. Bisa karena aliran darah kurang, misalnya gulanya kurang, hipoglikemi dan sebagainya. Maka in hijamah, ya, we can put the cupping, ya, yeah, in the head, ya. Yeah. When the cupping point we put in the head, it can be extraction the CPS, causative pathological substance that yang mengganggu aliran darah, perfusi darah ke aliran daerah kulit otak, scalp, maybe, and in the cerebral maybe, dan others. Okay, I think that's my answer.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hendra. The next question is from Al Said. Can we use hijama in patient uses while uses anticoagulants? Can we use hijama in patient who take some anticoagulants medicine, I think?
Thank you, Dr. Fardela. So, when some patient, they are take the anticoagulant drugs, yeah, like Concor, yeah, like the others, yeah, aspirin, aspilet, dan sebagainya. I think we must stop hijama. Yeah, I think we must prepare the patient from before the hijama. Yeah, because when hijama dilakukan, ketika hijama dilakukan, itu akan menyebabkan perdarahan, ya, luka. Maka apabila orang yang menggunakan antikoagulan, dikhawatirkan terjadi perdarahan yang sulit dikendalikan. Begitu kira-kira. Jadi harus dipertimbangkan, we must prepare our patient with anticoagulan drugs, ya. Any else?
Okay, the next question is from Noviati. She asks about pregnant woman. Can pregnant woman get cupping therapy and also use it for a pregnant woman, Dr. Hendra? Pregnant? Yes. Can pregnant woman get cupping therapy also?
Okay, thank you for the question. I think for the pregnant must be careful to cupping for the patient with the pregnancy. Yeah. So I think any condition that pregnant woman can be cupping. Yeah, they are if the pregnant woman in the third trimester, yeah, in the end of the trimester, I think it can be stimulate the oxytocin release as when the woman is pregnant, and that's so beneficially to help their apa labor the yeah to untuk partus, ya, yeah. So I think it better if the hijama when in trimester 3, in the end trimester 3, yeah, trimester. Terima kasih. Thank you.
Maybe for reduce the pain, Dr. Hendra?
Yeah, reduce the pain too, yeah, in
before labor.
Yeah, before labor.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hendra. The next question is from Diana. Is it the same or different between Bekam therapy or cupping therapy with COP therapy, traditional Chinese medicine? Is it different or same?
Yeah, I think not too different, but still have the different, because the TCM just puncturing and cupping and function. Jadi they are puncturing and langsung cupping. Just two method, yeah. But in Tibu Nabawi Hijama, yeah, we must cupping the first, yeah, and puncturing, and the end cupping again. So CPC, yeah, cupping, puncturing, cupping. I think there is a little difference, I think. Thank you, Doc.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hendra. Maybe this last question from, yes, Abdul Latif. Is any different between wet cupping therapy and dry cupping therapy with magneting needle at acupuncture point, and how long the best time doing the therapy at one point? Is there any different between wet cupping and dry cupping?
Oh, yes, of course. Any difference about cupping and dry wet cupping and dry cupping? Because when we just dry cupping, we just stimulate the skin surface, yeah, and also stimulate the keratinocyte, yeah, and the others local cell in the skin, yeah. But if you do not do the scarification kulit, skin scarification or puncturing, it will stagnant in the WAS or CPS that I say yang that must be must be filtered to extract from the body. But if you do the scarification, yeah, puncturing that can be that can extract the CPS that yeah that yang sudah terkumpul ya teraccumulate in area hijamah point or cupping point that can extract remove from the body to out body. So I think more benefit wet cupping than dry cupping. But there is many condition. Yeah. If sometime patient that have hypotension or hypoglycemia, I think, or like hyperthermy, demam, yeah, febris, I think don't treat hijamah with wet cupping therapy, but just dry cupping because it still can stimulate immune system in the body from the skin, yeah, but not extract, not get out the blood and the fluid in the body because can be make the patient dehydration. I think so. Thank you, Dr. Fardella.
Okay, okay. Dr. Hendra, thank you for the answer of the question.
Oh, yang bekamnya? Jarak bekam. Yeah, I think the first concept from hadith, yeah. The hijamah can be reuse, yeah, can be recycled in 1 month, yeah, like hijamah berdasarkan hadis Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam di tanggal 17/19/21 Hijriah. But sometimes we can do the cupping in the patient when he need the cupping for the therapy. If the patient have the pain, the patient have this organ disorder, I think we can do the hijamah or cupping even he is get the disease begitu. I think itu bisa dilakukan saat orang itu sedang sakit dan mengalami sakit yang berat sehingga membutuhkan pertolongan. Kalau memang if the cupping can bring the beneficially for the disease. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you to Dr. Hendra for the answer the question. Maybe I want to greet Professor Dr. Abdul Rahman. Can you join with us now? Professor, assalamualaikum. Miss Adinda, can Prof join us? I'm sorry, Prof, I cannot hear your voice. Maybe you can unmute first. I'm sorry, Prof, I cannot hear your voice.
Hello, hello. Can you hear me, please?
Yes, I can hear your voice, Prof.
Thank you very much, yes. Is it time for me to deliver my question, please?
Yes, it is time for you for 20 minutes. And then at the end of session, we can get discussion. Please, this time is yours, okay. Prof.
Thank you very much, our honorable dean of the medical faculty of Universitas Sumatera, Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera Utara, Dr. Hendra and all the committee and the MC, and all of you, our audience. Thank you very much. Good morning. I have to say thank you very much to you all to invite me then make me present my topic in this occasion. So please let me do my topic or deliver my topic in my mother language, Indonesia. So you, I hope you will more enjoyable to make it more understanding. Thank you very much for Ms. Tania to help me. Then please make this presentation full presentation. Okay, thank you very much. Oke, saya ulang. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih banyak kepada setiap siapapun dengan kepada yang terhormat Bapak Dekan, pimpinan institusi, Ketua Panitia, dan Dr. Hendra dan seluruhnya. Dan audiens, saya akan membawakan presentasi ini dalam bahasa Indonesia. Semoga Anda bisa lebih menikmatinya. My topic today, saya punya topik hari ini adalah complementary medicine terkait dengan akupuntur. Sorry, saya tidak lagi di Indonesia, tetapi akan saya coba untuk bisa presentasi lebih baik. Saya belum bisa presentasi pakai tab, sehingga tangan saya tidak bisa lincah memberikan keterangan yang lebih konkret. Tetapi betapapun, saya ingin semua audiens di sini bisa mengerti.
I'm sorry, Prof. I cannot hear your voice.
I'm sorry. How about this? Yeah.
Yes.
How about
this? Yes. Okay. Please continue,
dikembalikan,
Prof.
Dikembalikan ke presentasi pertama, Dino. Ah, yes, sih. Tunggu saya untuk bisa pindah presentasi. Oke. Okay. I'm sorry. First, I have to sampaikan konsep. Apa yang disebut medis? Medis adalah activities, apapun aktivitasnya itu, yang akan merubah sakit menjadi sehat. Itu konsep awal. Jadi aktivitas medis, apapun aktivitasnya itu akan mengganti sakit menjadi sehat. Salah satu aktivitasnya itu adalah akupuncture. Akupuntur ini tidak pernah digunakan selain untuk medis. Tidak untuk membangun rumah, tidak untuk membuat makanan, tetapi untuk merubah dari sakit menjadi sehat. Please, kalau bilang akupuntur, langsung konsepnya melekat bahwa itu adalah bidangnya medis. So, tidak perlu lagi ditambah dengan akupuntur medis. Karena dia bergerak di medis. Ini dulu dipegang. Kemudian yang kedua, saya akan mencoba memberikan konsep yang kedua. Dipegang dulu. Satu tadi tentang medis, yang kedua tentang hukum. Hukum itu paling tinggi, produk sains yang paling tinggi. Di produk sains di awal namanya ada hipotesis, tesis, definisi, itu ada di ekonomi kalau definisi, ada di sosial, ada konsep, ada di atas itu nanti kalau sudah lebih bagus lagi, ada teori, lalu di atas teori adalah hukum. Jadi produk sains tertinggi adalah hukum. Dan hukum semesta, saya bilang, hukum semesta, ini konsep yang nomor dua, tadi sudah kita bicara tentang konsep medis, hukum semesta adalah hukum pasangan. Kenapa kalau dibilang hukum of the universe? Karena dia berlaku pada semesta. Kalau berlaku pada semesta, maka yang kecil harus ikut yang semesta. Salah satu yang kecil adalah human. Salah satu bidang human adalah health. Salah satu bidang health adalah terapi. Salah satunya adalah akupuntur. harus ikut hukum semesta, pasangan. Maknanya apa? Pasangan itu ketika memilih satu, tidak memilih yang lain. Kalau dua, bisa dipilih semua. Kalau pasangan, tidak boleh memilih sepasang dalam waktu bersamaan. Contoh, ketika orang berjalan ke barat, pasti meninggalkan timur. Ketika orang berjalan ke timur, pasti meninggalkan barat. Ini konsep yang nomor dua kita harus pakai. Nanti kita akan masuk ke complementary medicine. Nah, saya akan coba ikat sedikit dengan teori Newton.
Ada suara.
Bunyi Newton itu salah satunya berbunyi begini, atau hukum Newton, karena naik pada dia hukum. Tadi kita bilang teori product science. Hukum Newton. Setiap aksi pasti menimbulkan reaksi. Kalau di bahasanya Dr. Hendra, saya begini. Fama ya'mal mithqala dzarra khair yara. Fama ya'mal mithqala dzarra syarr yara. Apapun yang baik pasti menimbulkan dampak, dan apapun aktivitasmu yang buruk pasti akan menimbulkan efek. Dalam bahasa imunologi disebut dengan stimulation dan respon. Oke, ingat ini konsep berikutnya lagi sesuai dengan hukum pasangan, kita turunkan lagi, setiap aktivitas kita akan menimbulkan impact. Impactnya itu bisa positif, bisa negatif. Dalam makna positif ini, yang saya maksudkan adalah bisa sembuh, bisa worse. Demikian juga acupuncture. Bisa mengobati, bisa sebaliknya. Hanya itu, tidak lebih, not more than. So please ini keep. Ini dipegang. Tadi ada konsep medis, ada akupunktur, dan kemudian ada hukum stimulasi respon. Apapun aktivitas kita, nah, satu, sudah sekarang. Berarti ada kemungkinan bisa work, bisa baik. Tergantung nanti durasi, tepat tidaknya, benar tidaknya, dan sebagainya. Kemudian yang berikutnya lagi. Berdasarkan hukum universe itu tadi, kita tidak boleh menghindar dari itu. Dan nanti kita ke belakang, kalau misalnya mau dalam dengan saya di arah filsafat, nanti akan lebih paham. Tentang hukum pasangan ini. Pasangan, barat, tidak ada barat kecuali ada timur. Tidak ada benar kecuali ada salah. Tidak ada terang kecuali ada gelap. Tidak ada siang kecuali ada malam. Jadi orang bilang siang, konsekuensi logisnya pasti ada malam. Kalau ada kanan, pasti ada kiri. Nah, ini dipahami dulu sebagai konsep dasar. Karena kekeliruan telak sampai di sini. Bahkan kekeliruan ini dipakai atau terjemahkan atau sampai melimpah kepada dirjen di level dirjen, di bidang medis. Saya tidak perlu sebut apakah Indonesia juga termasuk, apakah justru di Indonesia yang ada.
Okay, I'm sorry Prof, there is a request from the audience. Please use bilingual language, Prof. Maybe mix between Indonesian and also English. Thank you, Prof.
Okay, thank you very much. So please, realize that complementary make it pair. Both, not both, pair. One right and another side left. So complementary bahwa complementary itu saling melengkapi. Yang disebut complementary not alternative. Kita maju ke berikutnya. Next. Din, thank you. Ini apa ini? Nah, I will tell you and I will make it more convenient in Einsteinian relativity or Einsteinian theory. You can see over there that it's energy equivalent matter. In this theory, you can see that energy dan matter itu saling melengkapi, tidak bisa dipisah. We cannot separately, absolutely, but equivalent. So, if I have to change in the
physical side, there must be change also in energy side. Or in anatomical terminology or in Indonesian language, jika saya merubah fisik seseorang, pasti dia karakternya berubah. Atau ketika karakternya berubah, maka fisiknya berubah. Ini yang saya bisa terangkan dalam handstand. Di balik itu nanti, in another side, then I can therapy, I can use the method of therapy using physic and also non-physic. Physical or not physical. Let's continue the slide, please. Jin? Sorry. Yes. So you can be more clear this time that I mean that alternative you can see here. And then if I have told you, I have tell you char, you may see at the right set or the left set for my presentation or my slide, and the second one and the third one and the other one. It is the alternative, the terminology of alternative. But if I have to tell you the complement, not like this one. One and the pair, satu dan pasangannya saling melengkapi, itu namanya komplementer. Nanti saya akan berikan contoh. In the next slide, I will tell you, and then I will make it more simple with more examples about how I can manage my patient or my or can manage my cases from sick or ill to help. Next, please. Okay. Saya akan memperluas broad spectrum to make you more understand about the alternative like this one. So if sometime you may go to Mecca and then you not obey about the caution atau peraturan dan Anda boleh menggantinya menggunakan sedekah, puasa atau membebaskan budak. You can see over there, I deliver to you some ayah. And the Al-Quran at say about that. Itu salah satu contoh, this one, the example of the alternative. Bukan complement. Next, please. So if I told you, if I tell you acupuncture, it is not alternative, but convenient or more right if you call the acupuncture as the complementary medicine. Bahkan akupunktur menjadi the ultimate or the priority of a therapeutic model or therapeutic method to do something better, to do something more help, more relief pain, and then so on, to make case untuk membuat kasus menjadi lebih simple. Kita akan lihat nanti beberapa contoh. Kembali lagi, ditekankan di sini, bukan alternatif, tetapi komplementer. Satu, tadi di depan saya sudah memberikan peringatan bahwa akupunktur selalu di medis, tidak pernah akupunktur memasak, membuat bangunan, atau membuat sel yang lain. Yang kedua adalah akupunktur adalah complementary medicine. Suatu ketika menjadi yang utama, conventional medicine menjadi yang berikutnya. Suatu ketika dia berjalan bersama-sama conventional medicine, dan bisa jadi conventional medicine seperti dalam bedah, kalau memotong itu akupunktur tidak mengerjakan pemotongan, tetapi it's do as the its function to make not pain, like anesthetical role in the conventional medicine. Please let to the next slide, Dinda. Okay, I will let you know the simple ways. To the simple way to do my case is be helped. Let's see it. Okay, in this figure, you can see the arm or the hand of the patient. Udim, the bengkak, swelling in the right side, and then it cannot do flexion in the interpalang, and also in the radiocarpi palangial articulation. And how about
the other side. He can move his hand freely, enjoy, and then tidak ada menimbulkan sakit. But you can see at the right side, his hand cannot do like the left side. And after that, I will try to do something simple. But you know, I don't use my my therapeutic model in the right side, but I've done it in the left side. And you can see over there in a few seconds, the right hand of my patient can move freely, and he get better condition. With next, please, Dean. Next, please. Next slide, please. Okay. I'm sorry. Saya mohon izin sebentar. Okay. Sorry, please. Okay. So, acupuncture have the concept sehat.
I'm sorry, Prof. I cannot hear your voice.
Okay. Sorry. Acupuncture have their own concept about health. Yes, dia akupunktur dalam menerapi akan membawa to make all of the imbalance condition back to balance. In anatomy, balance condition like pair of flexion, extension, adduction, abduction, and then so on. And also about the parasympathetic activities and also the sympathetic activities. So the role of the acupuncture, or what I have done, or what I will do, is to make it more balanced. It is relative, depend on situational, temperature, and so on, sex, and then all the situation condition to make it balance. Make it back to balance. It is the health concept of acupuncture. So in this step, in this point, you can understand what I mean with balance, with what I mean with acupuncture, health concept of acupuncture. Tentu Anda semua tahu apa yang dikonsepkan oleh WHO about health. Sesuai dengan definisi WHO, it's a WHO definition about health. And you may understand that there's strong difference between the health concept of WHO and then acupuncture concept. So, dari sini, mengharap saudara, I hope that you all be realize that the acupuncture health concept have their own health concept. Okay, next slide, please. Okay. You know that tidak ada pengurangan materi tubuh in the this method. The way of I do to make it help, tidak ada penambahan, tidak ada pengurangan, tetapi it just some stimulation and point at the special point according to the claim or according to the compliance of the patient. And make it be help. Tidak ada menggunakan bahan luar, stimulasi dari diri sendiri. And from this statement, you can realize that the therapeutic model or medicine that used in this model of therapy di bawah include to the owner of the body or the patient, their self and their bersama mereka always be with their self all of 24 hours. Jadi bahan terapi yang mereka bawa tidak lagi harus menoleh ke apotek, tidak lagi harus mencari bahan dari luar, tetapi bahan terapi itu ada di dalam materi tubuh mereka sendiri. Itu beberapa kelebihan dari apa yang kita sebut dengan complementary medicine, especially in this case as a acupuncture therapeutic model. Next slide, please. And you may know that I do my therapeutic model not from the local compliant, but the patient before have the compliant in the right side of their his hand, and I do my therapeutic model from left side. And the result of the therapy make it his combined convenient enjoy and only few minutes or a few seconds, not till 1 minute. It's about in the 20 seconds, I think. Okay, and the second ada kelebihan lain yang pernah present in the dental journal that some patient have compliant in their gum di sisi mulut, tetapi saya menggunakan lokasi titik terapinya di daerah tangan, and then only one point. And beside of that, in another case, I can do this. Ini bisa divariasi, bisa di titik yang di tangan, dan also I use my point in other side of the hand, but I use it in the buttock or in the gluteal region as sebagaimana yang kita contohkan, yang kami contohkan pada kasus yang pada slide berikut. Okay, next slide, please. I see. So in this report, you can see over there the patient is the compliant in the gum, and then I do my therapeutic model in the right hand over there. So next slide, please. Here, another one also, and then I do my therapeutic model, and another side, it is in the buttock area or gluteal region. So ada keuntungan lain that I can do in my acupuncture model, therapeutic model, ialah bisa memilih titik sesuka-suka hati yang paling nyaman, that make my patient companion, and mereka merasa enjoy. Dan dua-duanya menghasilkan kesembuhan. Two cases have a result of recovery of their compliance. Next slide, please. And you may see over there, my video model, it is jarum yang bisa diganti, ya kan, dengan sengat lebah, sting of honey sting, like video that in my slide, ada di slide itu, saudara bisa lihat bahwa kami menggunakan sengat lebah. Untuk melakukan terapi, pasien ini mulanya akan dilakukan operasi pada tumor yang ada di lehernya, tetapi terapi lebah telah membantu dia untuk mengurungkan atau menunda terapi itu, atau menggagalkan terapi itu. Sekarang masanya kempes. Kenapa digunakan api terapi? Karena dia tidak bisa menggunakan jarum, dan orang ini ada di posisinya di Banyuwangi, di Baluran. Nah, dia tidak bisa menggunakan jarum, dia bisa menggunakan api terapi secara mandiri with himself. So, he can do it with himself, without a medical practitioner. Ini kelebihan lain yang bisa saya tampilkan dalam complementary medicine, especially akupuntur terapi. Next slide, please. Okay. So, I want to tell you more. I want to let you know that stiffness, itu banyak kasusnya, preference, till 16% in the world and also in Indonesia. And maybe one of you this time also have a complaint like the left stiff neck. I don't know how many of you that mendengar presentasi ini yang juga and also have the complaint of the stiff neck, yang memiliki keluhan stiff neck. Apa itu stiff neck? Kita coba lihat. The terminologi Indonesia terminologi kondisi medis ketika seorang mengalami not convenient in their necks and so on. And please you look it more in the ChatGPT or other sources in the internet, and then you make it yourself be clear about that. But the important thing here, I do my therapeutic model. It's a acupuncture model, and then you may see here some model that I have done it in my clinic or in our clinic, and then some points that I've done it in the 2nd August few days before. Here the patient. Next slide, please. Dean.
I'm sorry, Prof. Please, I will reminding for 10 minutes left.
I'm sorry. I can hear you. Your voice, please.
Okay. The time 10 minutes left, Prof.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you very much. I will end it. Sesuai dengan itu. I'm sorry. Next, please. Slide, please, Tim. Here, coba. So you can see over there the data complete in my clinic, and then this is the patient. Coba diputar, Tim. No. Yang tadi, Tim. Yang tadi. Pasien tadi, Tim. Yes. Please. Sorry, back. Ayo, Din. Any pasien dari Flores, come from Flores, and come to our clinic, and dia dapat recovery. Ini dikerjakan beberapa hari yang lalu. Okay. Next, please. Next slide, please, Tim. Yes. Okay. Next slide, please. Sorry. Ini tempat kami, please. Ini yang di Surabaya. Surabaya. Ya, itu Acupuncture Center. Ini klinik kami. Ini suasana libur, not a holiday.
Next, please, Tim. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Ini tempat kami yang lain di Madura, di Kamal. And then you can see over there, my tech, ada tempat praktek di belakang rumah. Itu ada beberapa figure yang menandakan bahwa tempat praktek juga dikondusifkan dengan taman dan sebagainya, air mancur dan lain-lain. And then next, please. Thank you for your attention. And then please let me know that if you have some question to me, and I will tell you more about our activities and also about the acupuncture, about the complementary medicine, and so on. Let me know. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof, for the presentation, for the great presentation, full of knowledge. And I hope that all of the participants will know about acupuncture. Maybe for the participant, please type your question in the chat box. Prof, there is a question. Are there any patients who are contraindicated for acupuncture therapy?
Scare, yes, or dia tidak makan, tidak minum, hypovolemic shock, dan sebagainya. Secara umum, not too much.
Okay, but
hand in the not right hand, artinya bukan pada ahlinya. Saya kira itu berbahaya. Istilah tidak diizinkan. Nah, it's prohibited, I think.
What about the emergency case, Prof? Is it okay if we are doing acupuncture therapy?
Yes, insyaallah. Antara lain, one of them in the pectoral engine, and then shock hypovolemic, pain yang keberatan sampai bisa neurogenic shock, and asthmatic, sesak dyspnea, and yes, yang saya ingat itu, that I remember. May you please ask more, mungkin ada yang mau ditanyakan lebih, artinya yang saya lupa untuk menjawabnya tentang contoh emergence. Apa yang mungkin para pendengar audience tahu, akan saya coba untuk jawab. Tetapi yang saya ingat adalah misalnya pectoral engine, sesak misalnya, terus dyspnea also, and so, saya mohon izin, sangat mohon izin, karena ini saya emergen, baterai saya tinggal 15%, mohon maaf,
okay.
Saya tidak bisa pakai tablet. Lalu kemudian apa namanya, power bank saya ada di grupnya, okay. Pergi untuk di lain tempat, saya di satu tempat yang untuk presentasi. Grup saya pergi untuk vacation, artinya untuk acara lain. Oke, tolong disempurnakan pertanyaannya, karena mungkin saya belum bisa enjoy with this presentation for more time. Thank you. Tolong, apa yang penting ditanyakan, silahkan, saya akan jawab.
Okay, Prof, maybe last question because of the time. How about to pregnant woman? Is it okay we doing acupuncture therapy, Prof?
Saya akan contohkan. Saya kan pernah mendapat first gravida, primary gravidarum. Dia dalam keadaan preeklamsi, bengkak seluruh tubuh, pakai oksigen, dan di atas kursi roda. Obstetrik bilang dia harus diterminasi. Umur kehamilannya 37 atau 36 minggu. Saya coba terapi, lalu kemudian more better, lalu kemudian obstetriknya bilang okay, diteruskan. Lalu kemudian menjadi baik, lebih baik, dan dia ditunggu ater, tidak digu prematur. Dan jadi, suatu ketika ada lain orang yang pregnancy terlalu obes, terlalu gemuk, dan mencerita bagi saya bagaimana caranya supaya tidak terlalu obes, sehingga kami bisa mereduce, dia punya tubuh dan berhasil bagus di akhir kehamilannya, tidak terlalu tinggi. Ada beberapa dan sangat menyenangkan. So, di dalam kasus apapun, asal tidak ada kontraindikasi, there are no kontraindikasi for acupuncture. I think it's acupuncture can help more convenience in the right hand. saya kira di tangan yang tepat, mengerti konsep dasarnya apa, apa dasar dia bertindak, apalagi dia mengerti anatomi, dan cerdas sedikit, smart sedikit, dan caring luar biasa, bukan untuk capital only, I think itu, saya kira itu pilihan tepat untuk memilih seorang akupunturis.
Okay, Prof. Is it okay if we have one question more, Prof? What about your battery of laptop?
Yes. Tidak apa-apa. Selama masih ada baterai saya, you bisa tanya apa saja dan saya akan coba membantu sebagus mungkin agar setiap orang mendapatkan manfaat baik dan setiap pasien more healthier. Itu yang dituju. Tidak hanya Indonesia, bahkan dunia. Saya berharap itu. Thank you. Please, kata ask me. For another question, please. Thank you very much for your question. For your bagus. Okay, thank you.
Okay, please. Thank you, Prof. Because we have a participant from outside too, not Indonesia, also. Okay, this is a question from our nutritionist. How about role play of acupuncture in obesity treatment, Prof? Is it okay? And what is the mechanism?
I'm not sure understand what's your question. Yes, please.
Yes. How please. About acupuncture for obesity treatment? Can it be Prof? And what is the mechanism?
Okay. I'm sorry. I have to back to my first concept. Every stimulation, every point stimulation, must effect. The pair of effect, whether better or make it help. Or worse, make it sick. So obat also memiliki efek, have the effect of therapeutic effect or not, depend on kapan kita memberikan, apakah sesuai dengan kebutuhan, or like this one, and also acupuncture the same with acupuncture model lain dari terapi, obat model lain dari terapi. Jadi kalau itu yang dimaksudkan adalah setiap jawabannya adalah setiap apapun kita, memberi apapun kita, mau better physical like obat and so on, atau energi like stimulation like, yang dilakukan oleh akupunktur bisa berdampak kepada sepasang efek, dia bisa efek dan sebagainya. Itu tentang mekanismenya agak panjang, jadi saya belum bersedia untuk memberikan mekanisme yang seperti sekarang, tapi mekanisme secara umum bisa dilihat di mekanisme secara konvensional medis, dia akan merilis lemak, lemaknya dimasukkan ke gliconeogenesis, lalu kemudian glukosanya meningkat, hiperglikemia akan menghantar untuk menekan hipotalamus agar tidak mengatakan lapar, sehingga hungry effect-nya akan turun, seolah-olah dia kenyang, padahal obatnya sebenarnya tidak berfungsi untuk mengenyangkan, tetapi hanya dia merilis glukosa yang tinggi dan menimbulkan efek feedback pada hipotalamus dan bilang jangan makan dulu, dan itu akan dipakai oleh oleh tubuh sebagai energi dan dia harus beraktivitas sehingga diproses energinya, dan salah satu efek dari energi itu adalah keluarnya air sehingga orangnya biasanya keringatnya berlebih, dan itu tidak diambil dari air tubuh, tetapi diambil dari prosedur pemecahan glukosa menjadi energi dan H2O. Itu sekilas keterangan tentang itu. Tetapi kalau bisa beri konsep, smart sedikit cara berpikirnya, akan mengerti bahwa efek itu yang akan ditimbulkan oleh medical regimen apapun itu. Itu apakah herbal, apakah non-herbal, apakah gizi, nutrisi, apapun namanya lah. Gitu, ya? Itu secara mudah. Oke, saya mau lagi ada pertanyaan yang lain. Kalau masih belum jelas, silakan.
Oke, Prof, there is a question from Swandi. He is interesting about apitherapy like bee bites. It should be allergy or not, Prof?
Oke, salah satu caranya supaya tidak alergi, saya tidak bilang alergi apa tidak, karena orang yang takut bisa alergi karena itu mengenai persepsi. Sekali lagi, alergi persepsi. Bagaimana keterangan tentang alergi persepsi nanti panjang ceritanya. Saya belajar kepada Dipa Chopra, saya belajar kepada Larry Ducey, saya belajar juga kepada Benny Siegel dan teman-teman tokoh-tokoh lain di dunia tentang bagaimana persepsi itu mempengaruhi. Dan juga psikosomatik, kami punya jurnalnya yang Q1 tentang persepsi itu. Tadi itu panjang. Lalu bagaimana caranya? Saya hantar saja supaya teman-teman lebih mudah tidak mengatakan atau tidak takut kepada alerginya. Kasih dia madunya dulu. Kasih minum madu dulu. Sehingga efek alerginya bisa ditekan. Dan insya Allah selamat. Saya kira ini yang paling penting daripada apa saudara bicara tentang mekanisme tentang alergi efek. Kalau itu kita bicara panjang, saya mempunyai pandangan sendiri dan dasar teorinya kuat dan bukti juga ada. Dan kemudian kami juga punya jurnal Q1 di level bagaimana psikosomatik ini bekerja. Gitu. Itu panjang keterangannya, tetapi yang saya masukkan adalah langsung saja bagaimana cara ngatasinya. Kasih dulu madunya. Setelah itu baru kemudian lakukan api terapi. Insya Allah beres. Gampang bukan? So, the easy way. To do, to make it a barrier, to do the allergy react, so you can ask the patient to drink some of honey from the bee. Asli, original honey, bukan honey yang, no. Thank you very much. Ada lagi, saya menunggu lagi, masih ada 10% baterai saya.
Okay, Prof, final question from Dr. Hendra Sutisna. How to explain about meridian in the neuroanatomy? Yes. How to explain about meridian in the neuroanatomy?
Okay. Thank you very much. You asked me about neuroanatomy. So you asked me about axon. There is a receptor and then effector. Kalau bicara tentang itu, lalu kemudian saya juga akan coba menghantar saudara mengerti bahwa neuron ada sepasang. Dia bagian terima dan bagian efektor. And then also ada yang bagian sadar and non, ada yang tidak autonomic. And the autonomic model, you also realize that the our neuron have the sympathetic part and then also parasympathetic part. Saya mau terangkan kepada saya, I will explain to you that the role of the autonomic neuron, it's about 88-92% depending on compare with the somatic neuron. Artinya bahwa tubuh kita regulatedly secara otomatis sebenarnya diregulasi oleh autonomic nerve. Nah, dari situ lalu kemudian meridian yang dimaksudkan di barat lebih di timur lebih ditujukan kepada hantaran yang simulasinya menggunakan autonomic nerve system ke arah pusat, tidak melalui somatik. Somatik membantu, tetapi lebih fokus kepada autonomic nerve system. Tetapi keterangan tentangnya ini pasti panjang lagi karena ini baru di dunia. Artinya saya bilang di dunia karena sampai saat ini belum mereka ungkap tentang meridian. Sehingga tadi di depan Dr. Henda menduga-duga bahwa itu hanya sebagai fakta empiris. No, kita akan mencari melacaknya secara scientific base, tidak hanya secara fakta empiris. Dan saya melakukan terapi itu, dan saya menggunakan model itu untuk melakukan terapi yang saudara sendiri melihatnya secara exactly, tepat, cepat, dan simple. Dan saya bisa buktikan yang menggunakan CCTV dan model dari pasien yang seperti saudara lihat itu. It's just my explanation about the meridian model. So please let me explain more in the another occasion or another kesempatan yang lain. Menarik sekali. Terima kasih pertanyaannya, Dr. Hendra. Thank you, Prof.
I think due to the limited time, even though there are still many questions that can we discuss, we must end the discussion, Prof. Maybe if there is a participant want to ask directly, maybe can send email to you or to Dr. Hendra. Is it okay, Prof? Maybe we can have another project soon. Okay.
Yes. Thank you very much for you, for Mr. Hendra, for Dean, for all the committee, and then for the our honor, all of audience from abroad also, and then from my original country, Indonesia. Thank you very much. And then,
Prof,
I'm sorry about this convenience. Thank you.
Prof, allow me to take a photo of us. with Dr. Hendra, yes. Also with all participants. Please, participant, maybe can open the cam. We can have a photo together. Mr. Yuda. It is done. 1, 2, 3. Okay, terima kasih. Thank you, Professor Dr. Abdurrahman, for the knowledge, and also Dr. Hendra, who give motivation to maybe all the GP not just learn about specialistic but also complementary medicine, Prof. Okay, see you at the next project, Prof.
Terima kasih, Prof.
Thank you, Prof.
Barakallahu fiik.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi. Oke, okay, thank you very much, Prof.
Jazakallahu khair, Prof. Dr. Abdurrahman. Izin nanti banyak belajar lagi, Prof.
Okay. Thanks to all the audience who joined this seminar from beginning until the end. I apologize if there are some mistake in mention the title and also my function as moderator. Maybe then I return the event to the host. Please, Sabil, this is your turn. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
All right, thank you very much for the speakers, Professor Dr. Haji Abdurrahman, MKS, and Dr. Hendra, for sharing the interesting knowledge with us. Hopefully this knowledge will be useful for all of us. Before I end this seminar, I'd like to remind you everyone to fill in their attendance list so they won't forget. And before we close the seminar again, Dr. Emni from the Magister of Biomedical Universitas Muhammadiyah Sumatera has an announcement to make. Oh, langsung aja. Oke. Ya jadi. Oke. All right. Let's close this seminar by saying Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. As a co-moderator, I apologize for any mistakes I've made. And let's read the concluding prayer. Subhanakallahu bihamdika, asyhadu an la ilaha anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Kamu baru lulus S1, bingung mau kuliah Magister Ilmu Biomedis di mana? Ayo mendaftar di program studi Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSU. Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSU telah membuka penerimaan mahasiswa baru tahun ajaran 2022-2023. Program studi Magister Ilmu Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSU membuka 4 bidang peminatan, yaitu farmakologi, biokimia, fisiologi, dan histologi. Laboratorium Fakultas Kedokteran UNSU telah dilengkapi fasilitas yang dapat melakukan pemeriksaan genetika dan biomolekular, pembuatan jaringan, animal house, dan pemeriksaan lainnya untuk mendukung pengembangan ilmu dalam dunia pendidikan kedokteran. Mari bergabung di program studi Magister Biomedis Fakultas Kedokteran UNSU. Bersama UNSU, unggul, cerdas, terpercaya.
pilih.